Hi, everyone, and welcome to our Understanding IELTS ExpertTrack Facebook Live. I'm joined today, at least I will be in a second once I find the right button. Okay. I'm joined today by Jenny and Neeraj. Hello, both of you.
Hi.
Hello.
And we'll be here for the next 30 minutes or so to answer all of your questions about IELTS. Especially today, we're going to be focusing on the listening test. But of course, if you have any other questions, you can ask them in the comment as well. And we're here to talk a little bit. This is connected to our Understanding IELTS ExpertTrack online courses, which are on the FutureLearn platform. And I'm going to start off just by asking Neeraj to tell us a little bit about those courses, if that's okay.
Yeah. So they are a collection, it's a set of four courses, and each one focuses on the different section of the IELTS test. So you've got a course on listening, you've got a course on reading, course on speaking, and a course on writing. If I remember correctly, each course is 3 weeks long, and they contain everything you'd need to know in order to maximize your score on each of the different parts of the test. It really takes you from zero right the way through all the kind of question styles, the strategies and the techniques you'd need, plus extra tips and advice to how to extend your study outside of not just exam practice activities, but how to, I don't know, for example, learn more vocabulary or ideas to practice listening to other accents, all that kind of thing as well. So there are lots of ideas for learning English in general, but how to direct that towards maximizing your score in the IELTS test.
And yeah, we have lots of questions coming in about some of the topics you've mentioned there already, so that's great. I mean, Jenny, Neeraj mentioned there that it takes you right from the beginning. So for people who have never studied IELTS before, or never prepared for IELTS before, it's great for them. But it's also great for people who have been studying and whose test is like next week or something as well. So maybe, you know, Nestor's asking, how can this course help us to improve and get a high score in IELTS? Neeraj mentioned some points there. Would you like to talk a little bit more about how it can really help?
Yeah. Sure. I think the key thing this course can do is it can help you to identify the areas you still really need to work on. So as you said there, Neil, often people join and they're at the beginning of their IELTS preparation, but sometimes we've had people join these courses and they've maybe just got a week or so to go. Mm. So the great thing about this course is you can either start at the beginning and work your way through from the beginning to the end, or you can think, oh, for example, I find multiple choice questions really tricky. I'll go and practice them, and then you can go directly to the steps. So there are very clear layouts. You can see what's happening each week, and it's very clearly titled what's happening every step of the way. So you can go and practice the bits of the test that you find challenging, and you may well know that already. In fact, a good idea might be to do a practice test before you go on the course if you don't have much time, and then have a look and see where you didn't do so well, and you could really target your practice going straight to the relevant steps.
So I think that's great, and we'll go on and take the questions now, but I think that flexibility that you're talking about there, that you can choose what you want to do, how long you want to spend, what you need more practice on and things like that, really makes a big difference. And you can go back and do it again and again and again, which you know, unfortunately with IELTS is something that you really need to do. So, okay. Lots of people joining us. Let me just give a shout out to some of the countries that we've got already here. We've got Bangladesh, India, Pakistan. All three of those joined together within a minute of each other. So that's one region taken care of there. Where else have we got? Italy, Mozambique, Morocco, Croatia, Peru, Colombia, lots more, Algeria, Ukraine, Taiwan, lots of Myanmar, Sudan, lots of them, people joining us from all over. So if you've just joined and if you missed what Neeraj and Jenny were just saying, we're here to talk about IELTS, especially today, our focus is on listening. So if you have any questions about developing your listening skills, practicing for IELTS, any questions about our course, about our resources, just let us know and pop them into the comments and we'll try and answer as many as we can. Let's go to another question first here from Kin Sumyat, who says, and this is a very common point, I find it challenging to understand what people are saying in the recordings because I have to listen, read, and write at almost the same time. Please, can you give us some tips? Neeraj, this is a common worry, isn't it?
Yeah, you've got a lot to do when you're doing the IELTS test. I mean, there are some good things to remember, that it's a test that each test has been tested previously on a bank of students to check that it works as a test. And there are kind of like traps. So they won't try to, for example, test you by giving you a gap that you've got to listen and write in, and then immediately there'll be another gap. So it's made in a kind of friendly way, so that it's not unfair. You won't be overloading your memory with too many ideas, because the prime objective is to test your listening ability. So it's not about your reading ability or your writing ability, although it is important to be able to read the question and understand what it's saying. And of course, it's important to be able to write your answers, but that's not the primary objective. It's about listening and understanding the conversation, the ideas in the conversation. There are lots of small tips we can give you, but it's really the collection of all these tips together put into practice that really affects your ability to get a high score. For example, using the breaks or the small amount of time you're given before the recording starts or in the middle of the recording to read through the questions and prepare yourself for the recording. That's, you know, really important use of your time. Marking keywords in the questions, underlining them, identifying exactly what information the question's asking you for. For example, is it a time or the name of a person or a price? So keeping those questions in your mind, you know, what information am I listening for specifically, so that you are not distracted by irrelevant information. And there's a whole, you know, list of these kind of tips that which are available in the course that you'll need to practice with to put together.
Okay. Jenny, anything you'd like to add to what Neeraj was saying there about how to balance all of this? And
yeah, I mean, I think as Neeraj mentioned here, focus is really important, and keeping focus is something that many learners on the course often say they have a big problem with, and that's when if you do drift off, it suddenly becomes very difficult to be able to write and read and do all the things you're supposed to be doing at the same time. So there are tips on the course to help you to become more focused. But I think when you're starting out, if you're quite near the beginning of your IELTS preparation, even just carefully choosing the texts you listen to so that they're fairly short when you first get started, and the kind of building up your listening stamina that way, that can be a good way to improve your focus. And also really the more you practice with the type of activities you get on the course, for example, or with papers from previous tests, the more you'll be able to juggle this listening and writing at the same time as well.
Okay, so maybe not just jump straight into trying to do the test, but do it in bite-sized chunks like that and then build up to it from that. Yeah, yeah. Okay, great.
Yeah.
Okay. Just another idea that I wanted to add, if that's okay. Using tape scripts as well. So when you listen, see if you can download as well the script, which is all the words that are said or the dialogue, so that you can follow that and then find where the answers are. Because a lot of the time when people listen, they think, okay, so that's the answer, but I didn't hear that word, or I don't know how that's the answer. And if you can see the words written later as you're listening, then you can edit, oh, right, okay, because they said that, I missed that, because there was a contraction or the accent or some other reason.
Okay, so a bit like Jenny was saying earlier about identifying what your problems are and what you need to work on. If you use the tape script, it helps you to figure out where you're going wrong and then work from that. Okay, very good advice there. A quick question that I can answer now from Rebecca Robles, who's asking, does the course have enough listening practice or resources to practice further? That's a very good question. And the answer is yes. Each of the courses has specific individual practice exercises to build up your skills, but it also has complete tests and complete sections of tests to practice. But I think one of the best things about it, from my point of view as a teacher, is that it curates resources. It collects together really good, reliable, trustworthy resources for you to practice with. So there's more than enough practice for you to go away after the course and do, you know, weeks of practice more for yourself. But we've carefully selected them all so that they really help you and really focus on the skills in the areas that you need. So I think that's a real advantage. Okay, let me move on. Lots of questions coming in already. A very, very popular question from Cricket Zone. Multiple choice questions are very difficult to understand. Why? We have another question related to this where somebody's saying that they sometimes have trouble having time to read all the options in the multiple choice, you know, as well while they're listening and doing all of that. So, Neeraj, what would you say to Cricket Zone and the others?
I mean, the timing is a challenge. In fact, those little breaks you get, they are little, right? They're like 30 seconds long. You know, I do sympathize with you. I would say even for a native speaker, it's hard to keep all of that in your working memory and then listen for, you know, several minutes and try to find answers. So it's something that you've got to practice with. So you, as Jenny said before, it's about building up stamina over time. Mm-hmm. It's not something you're going to, you know, get perhaps in a week. It's something that you build up over a series of weeks or months even. So you get used to listening to conversations which are 5 minutes long and answering, batches of 10 questions, like something like this. I mentioned earlier something about marking keywords in questions. I find that's a really useful technique because let's say you've got three options and you're marking keywords. You're focusing on listening out for not exactly those keywords, but it's going to be the synonyms of perhaps the antonyms of those keywords. You're not going to hear exactly those words used in the recording. They might try to trick you by using the exact same word, but it won't be the answer. So be aware of that as well. A lot of people make mistakes because they think that, okay, because they hear the word, it's the answer. IELTS doesn't always work like that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Jenny, any more multiple choice advice or pre-question reading advice or anything to work with that?
I think something that can be helpful when you're working through multiple choices and you've got all the answers and there's so many words, something to bear in mind is it often there are a couple of answers you can eliminate quite quickly. And if you do that and just quickly eliminate these answers, and then you're suddenly just left with two answers. There are often two answers which seem much more likely, and then it seems much more manageable and doable to be. And it will also cost you more time. It will save you time if you just have the two answers to go between and work out that way. So yeah, eliminating a strategy I'd also recommend. But the other thing that Neeraj was saying about often paraphrasing is a key feature of being able to do multiple choices. If you're finding multiple choices really difficult, it could be a sign that you really need to work on developing your vocabulary, which is really important for IELTS listening as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, very good point there. Okay, lots of questions coming in and lots more people joining us from all over, from Scotland, which is always good, from Mexico, from Ecuador, from Norway, from Peru, China, from China but living in Paris, Kazakhstan, Malaysia, and lots more there. A question, just bear with me for one second. I've lost it. Okay. From Slavica Shirets, who's saying, can we get some listening materials to try for free? Yes. Tina, Sally, who's you're on Facebook. Sally, who's answering some questions in the comments today, will share the link for you. We have lots of listening skills exercises on our Learn English and Learn English Teens website. Many of them are typical IELTS type listening content as well, and they go from every level, from A1, from beginner level, up to C1 advanced level. So there's lots and lots of exercises with questions, tasks, everything else that you can listen to, download, practice with, everything there. So no problem there. Now, this is a good question. I like these questions because there's no answer. So it keeps you both on your toes. Veronica Orden is saying, how much time do I need to practice for improving my English? Like I say, Neeraj, there's no answer to that because it depends on many things. But I think we can maybe talk about guidelines about, you know, spending time and allocating your time and stuff and things like that and how to use it productively. So what would you say to Veronica?
I think there's a few things, Veronica, you need to think about. In this context of the IELTS exam, firstly, what's your objective score? So, you know, what's the level you're trying to hit? What's your target? Knowing that first, is it band 6, which is kind of a B2 level, an upper intermediate level, or is it band 7, which is a low advanced level? And then knowing what your present level of English at the moment is. So are you already at an advanced level, or are you a bit lower at upper intermediate level? Is there a gap between the level where you're at now and the level of your target, your objective? Okay, that's one thing to know. So how big of a gap do you have between your present level and what you're trying to achieve? Then the other thing you've got to keep in your mind is, when do you want to take the test, or when do you need to present the results? So if you've got to present the results next week, you've got to put in a lot of work to get your level up between now and next week. And it might not be realistic to do that in that space, especially if you're working, you've got other responsibilities. So how much time do you have to put into English, work on your English between now and when you need to present the results? And that's the other thing to keep in mind is, like, how much time realistically do you have if you're working or if you're at school? How much time every day do you have for English? Have you got half an hour? Have you got 1 hour? Or, well, if you're completely free, can you dedicate the whole day to English?
Well, that leads me to what I was going to ask Jenny to kind of follow up on. I mean, Neeraj has spoken very much there about, you know, the very sensible approach, which is, you know, identifying your targets, the time you've got available, and then how you can work out your study plan and be realistic and all of that. But he just touched at the end on the fact of practicing every day. And one of the great things about listening, I think, is that you can practice it every day, everywhere. I mean, Jenny, what would you say about that for advice on this?
Yeah, absolutely. I think we all have more time than we realize. And it's a question of priority. So if you're working towards IELTS, then it is a priority for you because you're investing that time to do your exam.
So, and money.
Money as well, yeah, exactly. So you it's up to you to really then prioritize it. And even if you're very busy, we're all busy with work, with maybe family commitments, but you'd be amazed if you went through your day at how much kind of dead time we have on our hands that we're not really using for anything. And with the wonder of you know, smartphones and the internet, you can actually listen wherever you go and whatever you're doing. So you could be listening while you're cooking dinner, you could be listening in the bath, you could be listening while you're waiting for, you know, in the doctor's surgery or something like that, while you're walking to work. You know, you can be listening all the time. And if you know, there's different types of listening you can do as well. So you can do the very kind of focused, sit down and work through a task or activity listening, and that's really important that you do that kind of listening also. But it will also be really beneficial just to listen for enjoyment, to listen for pleasure, as you're going about your daily business. And there's so many great things you can find on the internet. There's some of the resources, and Neil mentioned, for example, there's what is it called, 5 minute English or something like that as well, where there's like a little 6 minute English. I'm so bad with numbers. You always get it wrong.
There's probably a new competitor that does it in 5 minutes, but
6 minutes, and it's a super little broadcast because you cover all sorts of interesting topics, and they actually take like some of the language then out of it and talk about it. So, you know, you're listening to them talk about language, so it's so good for your vocabulary as well. So really there's just loads of ways you can fit it in. And I think the key thing is as well, the less you feel it's like a chore, something, you know, that you have to get through but maybe isn't very enjoyable, the more you make it fun and interesting for yourself, the easier it will become to fit into your everyday life.
I think that's really good, and I think I think we should explore this a little more, because I have a very good question here from Hadi Hussein, which follows on exactly from what both of you have just been talking about. You know, I mean, we've been talking about this. You've just talked about how you can practice every day, and Neera just talked about how you can plan your time up to your test so that you make the most of the time you've got available. But, you know, a big question, I think, for people is, what should I actually do? What should I practice every day? Let's assume that they do have time and that they can put aside half an hour or 20 minutes or an hour a day or whatever. But, you know, what they should actually use to do that. You've mentioned one thing there. I mentioned some of our website content. But there is a lot. And I guess part of the problem sometimes can be to choose and how to use your time most productively. Because we also have comments from some people here who are saying, I've been trying many times now to get the score I need, and my score is not improving. So I think it's really good if we can maybe look at that and give some people advice on that. So Neeraj, over to you.
So, yeah, I mean, it was interesting that kind of question about people not getting the score that they need, having repeated the exam. It's quite common. And I think there's two main areas where we could think about working on listening skills. One is exam strategy and exam techniques, and the listening and the practice that we need for that. And also the other thing is building up general English listening skills, working on your vocabulary and recognition of the different pronunciations of words, that kind of thing. If you identify that your main problem is the way you are listening for exams, then what you really want to focus on is your exam listening technique. And I mean, the course is really great for that because it does give a lot of tips and specific practice on the question types. I think a lot of people miss out on getting their points, or they lose points by not understanding how the exam works and how the questions work and how the listenings are related to the questions. So working through exercises that take you through the exam style questions and giving you tips on that will help you with that specific aspect. The other thing is general English comprehension, listening comprehension. So vocabulary is a big one. You know, a lot of people say, I don't understand it because I don't know what the words are. So you need to build up your vocabulary about different topic areas. So listening to, for example, podcasts about topics, like, for example, the British Council Learning English website, we've got podcasts on the world of work, business topics, like, for example, marketing or advertising and selling and negotiating meetings, that kind of thing. Or it could be the environment or technology or these kind of topic areas. So that will build up your vocabulary within the specific topic areas. I think you need a mix, really. You need that specific exam practice, and you need the listening that builds up your English.
I think that's very true, and that's certainly what I always say to my students. And Jenny, you were saying earlier that I think a challenge is to not make it a chore sometime, because motivation can be a problem. You spoke, I mean, of course there's motivation, you're investing time and money, and probably, you know, whether you have to go to university or whether you have to migrate to another country, you have a motivation outside. But even then, when you've got, you know, work and children and everything, it can be difficult to keep up your motivation to practice every day unless you're enjoying it in some way. So what would you say about maybe what would the last part Neeraj was talking about there, that you know, the exam part is very clear what you've got to work on and what you've got to focus on and practice with. But you mentioned one good resource already. Any other suggestions of how people can find things that are difficult enough to help them improve, but interesting and fun or enjoyable enough to kind of make them want to listen?
Yeah, well, we do share some really good links on the course. Is it the BBC page? There's loads of really good podcasts. But I'm trying to think.
The general BBC podcasts. Yeah, I mean, they're like between 5 minutes and 15 minutes long, usually.
I mean, what to do to get you started is just, you can search. So just search into the little search bit for a topic that you're interested in and start that way. I guess just to contradict myself, the flip side of this, of all this, and this is something we also speak about in the course, don't make the mistake of, say you're interested in fashion, for example. Just only listen to things on fashion, because then you turn up for your test and it's you have to listen to a recording on something you're not particularly interested in. Then it'll be a real shock for you. So something we suggest doing on the course is, by all means, start off by listening to things you're interested in. Mm-hmm. After a while, you should really start to push yourself and listen, get comfortable listening to things that are outside your comfort zone, and as many different types of topics as you possibly can.
Yeah, Spotify is great for that as well, for looking for podcasts or Apple podcasts. But it goes back to what you were saying there, it's about balance, isn't it? And the balance won't always be the same, will it? I mean, as you get closer to your test, it might shift, but it's like balancing exam practice with general extensive listening. Okay, I just wondered if you were going to say anything. Okay, are you okay, Neeraj? You look distressed.
Yeah. Did you want me to comment on what you said there, or we're going to go to another question?
I always want you to comment, but okay, right, no problem. Let's move on. Let's have a look at what else we've got here. Another point, which all of these are, of course, linked, because, you know, you can't separate things out so easily. Listening involves so many parts. But Mominul Islam is saying, how can I understand fast conversation? So I guess, Neeraj, this is about how to build up the stamina, maybe you were talking about earlier, how to go from perhaps things that are designed to be easier to be understood to real conversation where people are speaking naturally.
Yeah, I mean, I had a student who had this particular problem, and he was intermediate level. And I said to him, let's put the shoe on the other foot. I said to him, my situation when I first came to Spain and I was trying to listen to fast conversations, my level was quite low. I started off by just catching the main drift or the main idea of the message, bearing in mind the context I was in. So, you know, if I was at the supermarket and I overheard a conversation about, you know, the two people talking about what fruits and vegetables were available, I could catch the general idea, taking into account the context I was in.
Yeah.
So think about, you know, the situation that people are in when they're having that conversation and how the words that they're using might link to what they're talking about. That's, you know, that's quite a lot of information already to take in, depending on your level. But if you're, you know, listening to native speakers and you're at a lower end of the scale for your English, that's quite a lot to take in already. You don't need to understand absolutely every single detail of the conversation. So, you know, don't feel that kind of pressure. Nobody's going to expect that. Especially, you know, a lot of native speakers have dialect forms, or they're using vocabulary that's very kind of localized, and it's not the same way you'd get English in a textbook. You know, it's quite different sometimes, the kind of English that's presented in textbooks than you hear on the street.
Yeah.
If you imagine where you live, right, the way you might speak to your friends in your country, and if somebody had been learning your language from textbooks, if an English speaker had been learning your language from textbooks, they came and listened to you, to your friends, they probably wouldn't understand everything. So, you know, put yourself in the other person's position, but ask those kind of big questions like, what is the general topic of what they're talking about? I caught some numbers. What could they be related with? Keep the questions going in your mind, and that will kind of help you to hook onto the information as you're listening to it. I find that really helps. If you're in a face-to-face situation, that's when you can, you've got to, as they say in the Spanish or in English, you'd be really cheeky and stop people in mid-conversation. So what did you say there? Or, you know, get repetitions and ask people to clarify what they say as well. Like, you need to be quite brave, but you get used to it.
Okay, great advice there. Jenny, anything you'd like to add to what Neeraj said there?
I think Neeraj's advice is excellent, but maybe just to emphasize the point that spoken English is just so different from written English. There are so many things we do when we're speaking English. Again, this is covered on the course, I think, but like, for example, speakers often make false starts. So they'll go to say something and then they'll change their mind and say something else. And this can, you know, you might come across this in something you're listening to. So it's being aware that really spoken English really is totally different, and it has its own logic and its own structure. And the more you listen, the more you become prone to practice again. But the more you practice listening to conversations, the better you'll get. For example, this conversation Neil and Neeraj and I are having at the moment, if you wrote it down, I don't recommend you doing that because it would take you weeks. But if you wrote it down, you'd see we're not really speaking in sentences. We're kind of saying words and then changing our minds and saying something else. So the more you're aware of this and the more you practice listening to this kind of conversation, the better your listening skills will become.
Yeah. I mean, transcripts are normally cleaned up, but when you actually see an unedited transcript, like you get sometimes for court cases of people speaking, it just goes all over the place. People start, stop, go back, circle around, you know.
Once I watched one of these Facebook Lives with me on it, with subtitles afterwards, and I was absolutely horrified. I thought I was giving coherent answers, but they were it was just words, random words.
Tell people that.
you reminded me of something there, Jenny, about pronunciation features of fast spoken English. You know, like weak sounds and elision of sounds, and also the joining up of letters, like you know, when if you see the word cut up, if it's said fast spoken, cut up. So the consonant passes over. That kind of knowledge of those features of spoken English can often help people to understand words in fast spoken English as well.
Yeah, very good point. And as both of you said, I mean, practice really makes a big difference. I mean, I recently changed devices, so I'm getting a lot more social media videos in Slovak than I got before, rather than English. And just seeing them every day and watching these people speaking is really... It's like you said, Neeraj. I mean, you know, I'm just understanding more and more that I didn't understand before, just from repetition of just seeing people speaking. I've got enough to know what's happening, and then my mind is filling in the gaps, which is really helping. Okay, a comment from Suresh Krishna here. Suresh doesn't say whether he's happy about this or not. I'm hoping that this is a yes. But when I open my social media, all videos are from British Council. Like, I guess that means I'm doing my job, so that's good. Okay, let's have a look and see what else we've got here. Bear with me. Sorry about this. I've got a lot of... Okay, just a few people confirming what you were saying, both of you were saying about the you know, the everyday practice and how much it improves and so on. Okay, some people are asking about speaking and writing here. That's fine. Don't forget that the Understanding IELTS Expert Track, as Neeraj said at the beginning, has four separate courses for listening, speaking, reading, and writing. So if you follow the link and take a look at the link that you'll find in the comments, you can sign up for 7 days and look at all of the course and look at the parts that are interesting for you or not. And we will be having more of these regularly where we look at different skills. So I don't know what the next time is. But we will be doing speaking, reading, and writing. So keep watching out for more live events like this, and then we'll have a look at that. Okay. Sorry, just for a second.
May the 6th, that's the next one. May the 6th, Thursday, May the 6th, same time we'll be talking about the reading parts of the IELTS.
Reading, okay, good. Good, because reading is also another one that we often get lots and lots of questions about, so that's great. I'll be with you in just one second. Okay, a very specific question here from Anas Alzumor. People worry about this a lot. You're listening. We've spoken about how you have to listen, understand, read, and write your answers at the same time. People sometimes worry about the forms, the format for this, especially for things like dates or numbers. And Anas is asking, is there a rule? How can we write this? Do we write as numbers or as words? For dates, for example, could be 30 June, 30th of June, the word 30th of June, etc. Which one of you would like to say a little bit about this?
Well, I mean, as far as I've seen in the examples I've looked at in all the test books, both those forms are okay using the number or the word, like one O-N-E. Both answers are accepted, except where the question specifically states use a number and a word. And you can only write one word. So if the question limits you to only writing one word, then you're kind of obligated to use a number form. But it's very rare. I've hardly seen any of those. In most of the questions where you're asked to write down a date, they accept both the number and the word written. And also the order of the American style or British style date system, generally they accept both. Have you seen any differences to that?
No, I think any standard format is accepted, like you said, and I think all of the possibilities are there. So, you know, whether it's 30th, the only thing that I would say is that I sometimes get with my students is that sometimes they use the wrong format. So it's worth learning what the accepted formats are in English. So, for example, TH, I have some students sometimes that write like... tooth instead of second and things like that and ones like that. So maybe just to make sure that you actually know what all the different formats are. But then I think, as you say, anything that's correct and acceptable is fine. Okay, we've really run out of time, so I'm just going to put in a couple of very quick questions here at the end. From Monique Barrett, who's saying, we spoke earlier about podcasts and websites and, you know, exam practice, things like that. Monique's asking, is it a good idea to listen to audiobooks for vocabulary? Jenny, what would you say to Monique on this?
Yeah, absolutely. Audiobooks are a great way of developing your vocabulary and probably very motivating as well if you enjoy listening to stories. So yes, my answer would be just as long as you make sure you also listen in your preparation to the kind of texts that will come up in the test. You know, make sure you include that in your practice as well. But yes, audiobooks are a great way to improve listening and develop your vocabulary.
So it comes back to Neeraj's point earlier about balance and working out how much time to spend in each one. But definitely, it's one good option. Okay, I'm just looking for the very last question. I can't actually find it to put it on the screen, I'm sorry, but it was another question from Rebecca Robles, who was saying, as an English teacher, as a private tutor, would you recommend doing the course myself so that I can help my own learners, or would it be more advisable to invite my learners to do it along with me? That's a good question. Neeraj, what would you say to this?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, do the course yourself to understand all the ins and the outs in detail about the types of questions and the techniques that are being proposed on the course so that you can see how they work. Apologies, I've got an ambulance just driving outside my flat here. Okay. Yeah, absolutely. Definitely. It's great to know what your students will go on and look at. You can select things from them because depending on what level your students are at and also what language they have, they might have more trouble with a certain aspect of the exam, And so by you doing it first, you can also select and say, okay, I think my students are going to have more trouble with the multiple choice, so let's focus on that part of the course.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Jenny, anything you'd like to add to that?
Depending on your teaching situation, it can also be quite nice to do some of the activities together as well. Mm. So by all means, have your students just join the course and work through it themselves. But some of the activities are just really good to do as a class. That way you can also sort of, see your students' progress as well. But I'm trying to remember there was one, I've done quite a few of the activities with my class in the classroom. Mm. And some of them are really good to do together. So there's one, for example, where you're learning to guess the meanings of words from their context, and it's a really good fun activity. And I've done that a few times with different classes, and it's just gone really well. So yeah, that's something to consider as well.
And I guess it's really good for kind of flipping your classroom as well, and kind of asking them to do it at home, and then spending your time with them on focusing on what they got, what problems they had, and kind of focusing on those areas. And rather than spending your time together with them listening for 15 minutes, they can listen before they come to you about that, and kind of you can focus on, okay, let's apply some of the rules and try again with that. Yeah. Okay, we've run out of time. We've gone way over time. So I'm going to just ask you both for any final messages to the people watching. Let's start with Jenny.
First of all, thank you so much for all your questions today. They were really interesting, and I hope the answers were helpful. And there's so much great material out there for listening. So the world is really, your oyster when it comes to practicing your listening. If you haven't already joined the course, I definitely recommend you doing so, because I think nothing can beat it for just a comprehensive look at getting yourself ready for the test. Mm-hmm.
Okay, Neeraj?
Yeah, I'd echo exactly what Jenny said. Thanks a lot for all your questions. Really interesting discussion come out of those questions. Mm-hmm. And check out the links that we're providing on our Facebook page, and try out the course. You've got a 7-day free trial, so see if you like it, and explore what materials are there for you. And hopefully we'll see you here on the next Facebook Live in a month's time.
Yep, and I look forward to seeing both of you as well. The last thing I would just say is, some people have been saying in the comments that they, like you mentioned earlier, Neeraj, that they haven't been able to get the result they want, they're a bit unhappy and everything. All I would say to everyone watching is that absolutely you can get the result you need. It might take some time, a lot of practice, but there's no one watching here today that cannot get the result they need if they actually put in that practice and really work at it with time. And are realistic with that. So just keep working at it, keep trying, keep working with the things we've done. Good luck with all your studies, and we'll see you again for the next one of these. So bye for now.
Bye-bye.